You know, there is no one way to be disabled. So obviously this video isn't going to be appropriate for every single illness or disability, but I still think it could help people, so that's why I wanted to do it. Hi lovelies, welcome to today's video. So as you know, I love Disney. There's Sully and Mike on my top, but they're just out of shot. Hey Sully. So yeah, I love Disney. I have been to Disney World twice and Disneyland Paris twice, and I'm going back to Disney World Florida for the third time next year. If you don't know and you're new here, hi, welcome. I also have a life-threatening long-term disease called lupus SLE. And I have other health problems as well. That's not the only one I have. They also suspect currently that I also have fibromyalgia. I suffer with chronic migraines. I have chronic rhinitis. So I have a lot of chronic illness, basically. And, you know, there is no one way to be disabled. I am a part-time wheelchair user. I have to use a wheelchair when I need to. And I do have to use a wheelchair in Disney parks and in airports and stuff like that, because the way that my illness affects me means that I can't stand for long periods of time, I can't walk very far, I get really, really bad and dangerous swelling and inflammation of my joints and my muscles and just everything, my whole life swells up. So obviously this video isn't going to be appropriate for every single illness or disability, but I still think it could help people, so that's why I wanted to do it. I can only talk from my experience and what helps me and what I've learned from my trips. I'm sure there's far more experienced people out there who also have completely different ways in which they are disabled and completely different ways in which they will need to plan their Disney holidays. But for me, this is what helps and this is what I've learned. And going forward, I think this will be our best Disney trip ever because we have learned from our mistakes. So let me help you not make the mistakes I've made. So I'm just gonna kind of go through my little list that I've made on my phone, and some of them I'll explain more and some of them are just pretty straightforward and simple. My first one is to get sun hats. Lupus affects me in that I can't be in the sun long. UV rays are like the worst thing for me. It makes my body and my disease flare up, so I can't, yeah, it's really bad for me, and especially on my scalp it will cause my hair to fall out. So get sun hats, but that's a tip for everyone. It's incredibly hot in Florida. You do sometimes have to be stuck outside in it, like if you're queuing for parades or for food or for rides, you can often get stuck outside, so sun hats are always a good idea. This time when I go back, I'm also going to take a sun parasol, like a sun umbrella, just because there were times that even the disabled area, for instance, for parades, you know, you get there an hour before, but you're sitting in your wheelchair in direct sun, and it just is boiling. That's not good for anyone, even if you don't have a condition that's affected by the sun. So I am definitely going to take a little sun parasol just to try and get a little shady spot wherever I need it. Because yeah, there were times where we were stuck and then I ended up having to just move and lose my place and not watch the parade, because I could not be in the sun any longer. Sort a wheelchair out in advance for the airport if that's what you need. I'm going to do that this time. I have never done it in advance before, but ended up needing it every time. And I feel stupid admitting that because it's been multiple times I should have learned. But if I'm not in a flare up at the time of my holiday, I'm like, I feel great, let's go, let's go. But also my everyday life isn't the same as a day at the airport. So I do need a wheelchair at the airport. I cannot stand in those queues. I cannot walk the amount you need to walk. It's just impossible for me. And this time I'm definitely going to be focusing more on managing my symptoms and preventing them from getting worse rather than waiting until I'm absolutely desperate to use an aid of some sort, like a wheelchair. So I'm sorting a wheelchair in advance, which I've been told I need to go through my airline. So we booked with Virgin, so that's who I need to contact about sorting out a wheelchair when we're at the airport. Also, I'm gonna ask for front seats on the plane. There are seats that are normally on the plane that can be for people with different health problems or health needs or concerns. Because of my swelling and because of just how much pain I'm often in with my joints and stuff, I cannot stay in the same position for long. So a 9-hour flight is really difficult for me, and if I'm tucked away in the middle somewhere of people, it's just really bad. We do deliberately pay for premium seats, premium economy this time, where I think it's just premium, it's not premium economy. But there's also one above us, we're kind of in the middle. But that was because my brother has been on this exact flight before and said that if you get the front seats of premium section, you have the most legroom you're ever going to get in a plane, which is what I need, purely because I need to be able to stretch out, change positions, get up. When it just needs to be easy for me to move around, basically, in order to stop the pain and the swelling. Ask for a room that's near the amenities. So that also includes the bus stops, because when we went last time to Disney World, we were in Disney Caribbean Beach Hotel, and that is a huge resort. And this time we're going to Animal Kingdom Lodge, and that is also a huge resort. I think they're all huge resorts. But the walk last time from the room to the bus was quite far. At the end of a long day, like, it just killed me. First thing in the morning, I'm like, okay, yeah, it's not that bad, let's go. But at the end, I literally couldn't walk. And when, I don't know if it's changed, but when I went in 2016, they didn't have any wheelchairs you could hire at the hotels. So then I was totally stuck. I literally had no choice but to walk to my room, and it was awful. I cried every step. So I don't want to go through that again. So this time I'm going to ask for a room that's as close as possible to where I need to be able to get buses and be near the amenities at the hotel. Lots of sun cream, people. Just seriously, like, especially for me, like I said, the sun, heat, UV rays is all the worst thing for me. So when I went last time, I hadn't actually even seen a specialist yet. I wasn't on any treatment for my disease, which is terrible. So I didn't know what I was doing. So I just applied sun cream like I always would as a pale kid. First thing in the morning and maybe once in the day. And that's just not enough for a person whose condition is affected by the sun, by heat, or by the UV rays. So this time I'm gonna set an alarm and I'm gonna apply it vigilantly every 4 hours, or if I've been in the water, even sooner. Also with your sun creams, check that they are like a high factor. I use factor 50, but also check that they have as many stars as possible out of the 5 stars that's on the bottle, and that they have UVA and UVB. You want all of those things ticked, because otherwise it means that your sun cream isn't as useful as it could be. Use the free Disney water. This was something when we went in 2012 we had no idea existed. So when we went back in 2016, I'd done lots of research and I could not believe it, because we had spent so much money on bottles of water, and I also don't like bottles. Like, I'm trying to not use plastic bottles and stuff, just to help the planet. We both are, so we're both conscious about that kind of thing. So we learned that you could get just like a cardboard cup of water around, and also sometimes I kept hold of my cup. If I knew we were walking far across the park or whatever, I got it filled up with water for completely free. You just go up to any like food stand and say, can I have a cup of water please, and they'll offer you ice as well. I got that, drunk it, kept hold of my cup, and then reused my cup when I got to a new stand. It's just a great way to like not cause any extra waste, and you know, a little cardboard cup weighs nothing in your bag. So yeah, it was just a great way. And then you're hydrated. Please, please be hydrated. This is for everyone, even without health problems or disabilities. But you know, if you have health problems and you're on medication and stuff, just please make sure you're hydrated. Drink all that free water. Make use of the fact that it's free. Drink as much as you can, as much as you want. That's what we did, and it really did make a difference. And this time I'm gonna use it even more and drink as much as I possibly can whilst we're there, because the amount you're sweating because of the heat and the walking is crazy. It's really easy to get dehydrated, so please just drink and take use of the free Disney water. Stay in the shade whenever possible. Just seriously take as many like shade breaks as you can. There are lots of spots where you will want to be in the parks that are in direct sunlight, and that you can't really like odds. That's just the way the park is and the way the sun is. It's a very sunny, hot country and place. So just make sure you are taking some time out, because no one really does well on a 12-hour day in direct sunlight constantly. You know, you really don't want to end up with heat stroke. And again, that's another one that I know you're probably saying, well, that's for everyone, and it is, but if you're like me, I have so many health problems that I already have to take care of. I don't want to take care of an extra thing like sunstroke. I don't want to have to worry about extras. I've got enough on my plate with my conditions and managing my pain and managing my meds. I don't want to have to then end up at the first aiders with sunstroke that I have to then look after. So yeah, just please make sure you're taking shade breaks as much as possible. Be really conscious of like, how long have I really been in direct sun? Okay, it's been actually quite a while. I'm going to take myself off and sit in the shade for a while. And just teamed with that, regular rest breaks. This time I'm trying to be more strategic with planning. So if I know that we've got extra magic hours at Magic Kingdom and we'll be there till 2 a.m. or 1 a.m, I'm not going to plan to be up at 6 a.m. the next morning, because physically my body can't do that. I need rest, I need recuperation, I need to like recharge and reset. So that is not enough sleep for me. I am fatigued anyway with my condition, and if you suffer with fatigue to do with your health problems, just please, yeah, make sure you're factoring in enough rest for you. Be realistic. If it's your first time going, I really can't express enough how huge the parks are and how much you'll be on the go constantly. It's exhausting. The trip is exhausting. It's not a relaxing break. It's a lovely relaxing break from reality, but in terms of physical, it can be excruciating. The amount you walk, the amount you're doing, you're swimming, you're climbing upstairs, like, or even if you are using your wheelchair, just the heat and the amount, it's just a sensory overload. You will be exhausted, so make sure you factor in rest breaks. Make sure you factor in, okay, that I need to make sure I'm getting enough sleep, enough rest during the days. Also, using water parks as rest days is a really great way to do it, because I love the water parks, and then you don't feel like you're missing out on the Disney fun. You're still in the Disney magic, you're still doing something, but you can just float around. You can just float around on a donut in the Lazy River all day, and then your body's resting. That's for me. I know that won't be perfect for everyone and for every disability, but for me, water parks are a great rest day. Rest day. This time I'm actually going to hire a mobility scooter. So the way that it works in Disney, I don't think is the best, but you can hire wheelchairs or mobility scooters at the parks. Last time I hired wheelchairs and it killed my boyfriend off. It's too hot, he had to push me around, the parks are hilly. So this time I'm going to get a mobility scooter, but I'm going to practice beforehand in Tesco's and stuff, because I am terrified of running over some poor child or Mickey Mouse. So yeah, but you can hire them. You have to pay every day. That's why I don't like it. I wish they did it how theme parks in this country do it. I know that one of the theme parks I used to work at in the UK used to do it, that you gave them all your details and your card details. You took a thing, it had a number on it or a colour on it, and if you did not return that exact one in perfect condition, then you were charged. But if you did, there was no charge. I wish it was that way, because it ends up very expensive. I think it's like $50 a day. When you're doing a 2-week trip, that's a lot of money. But you kind of have no choice. Bringing a wheelchair isn't an option for me. And like I said, I don't own a mobility scooter and I don't need one in my day-to-day life. And if I do, I can get them for free at places that I need them. So yeah, but hire them if you need them. That is, you are able to do that. The way it works is that they don't have them at your hotel. You'd have to get from your hotel to your bus. When you get off the bus, there's wheelchairs there or there's people there. So you get off your bus, you take a wheelchair that is literally just for getting people to and from the park and the wheelchair and their buses, sorry. If there's none sitting there, you can ask someone and they'll bring you one. That also just is so faffy. I wish it wasn't that way, but it is. I don't know what would be a better solution, but that seems really awkward to me. But yeah, you get off, because it is quite far from the buses to some of the front of the parks, so use that wheelchair. Then when you get through the gates, you can get a wheelchair for the day at the park. But like I said, at the end of the day, you have to hand that back in, and then go and do the same on the way back. It is quite faffy, but just know that that is an option if you need it. Definitely use your fast passes. When I went and I was in a wheelchair, I could on a lot of times you just kind of skip the queue just from being in your wheelchair. They ask you if you can transfer or if you can't transfer, like if you need to stay in the chair or if you're able to just do a couple of steps to get off the chair. Sometimes they'll ask you, can you handle a couple of steps? All of that, just be very, very honest. Like, just there's no point in lying. You're not going to be any worse or better off. They just need to know how to help you. They are extremely helpful at Disney and very, very good at Disney World. Disneyland Paris didn't have the same experience. Disney World, they were all amazing. Often you go through the fast pass or the exit queues when you was in a wheelchair, and I transferred, they left the wheelchair there, and then I got back in. It had my name on the back, and I got back in when I got off the ride. But on days or moments where I felt able to, I still have this awful thing about not liking using wheelchairs. If you're new here again, I've not always had to use a wheelchair or been unwell. It's only been a few years now, so I'm still adjusting and learning. So yeah, I still have like a weird thing with wheelchairs. So I try always to not use one unless I really, really have to, which I am trying to change. I'd rather use it and not be in pain and screw what anyone else thinks, because I hate the whole you don't look disabled thing, which people do get still in 2018, which is really sad. But yeah, if I ever felt I could, I would book a fast pass, because normally there's no queue in the fast pass queues. In Disneyland Paris again, I often found that there was queues in the fast pass queue. You'd still have to wait. So that didn't often work for me. But with the fast pass queues in Disney World, every single time we just walked straight on and got on the ride, which is amazing. So if you can walk for a little bit and you that just is your illness, that you don't normally use a wheelchair but you can only walk a certain amount of times, definitely the fast pass is a great way for you to not have to stand in long queues for a long amount of time. I know that goes for a lot of people with autism and stuff. When I worked at that theme park, I often spoke to families who had people in their party that were had autism or other conditions that are like autism, and often, especially with autistic kids, they struggle to queue for a long amount of time. So for those, it would be perfect for you to like regimentally plan all your fast passes so that you're never having to queue for a ride. You know, bam bam bam, this fast pass, then this fast pass, then this one. Because I don't know how that would work in terms of, I don't know if they do a pass for people with things like autism rather than your wheelchair user. I've not obviously experienced that, since that's not my scenario. But yes, the fast passes are a great way for you to not have to queue for long times. Wear thin clothing because of the heat and the humidity, but try to cover up if you can, because of the heat, and especially like when I was in a wheelchair, I just felt like such a sitting duck in the burning, scorching heat, that I had this really, really like paper thin cardigan. But just even having that over me was keeping my like legs in the wheelchair cooler than when I didn't have it and I was just wearing shorts. Because, you know, I often found it when I've been in September too hot to wear trousers or long sleeves. But just having something thin, or even like one of those shawl scarf type things that's really, really thin, that you could just put around you just to give yourself some protection from the sun when you're stuck somewhere in your wheelchair or even standing somewhere, is a good thing. Definitely get sunglasses that are decent. You do not want to be squinting the whole time. I bought a cheap pair when we went in 2016 and they were awful. I ended up not being able to wear them because I put them on and went out in the Florida sun and was like, ugh, I literally couldn't see, I was squinting, my eyes were watering. Please get ones that have got proper protection, that actually are tinted, that work, because you're out in the sun for such a long amount of time. For me, I always make sure I have steroids with me and also painkillers. Steroids is because when I have a flare up, I often break out in an incredible nasty rash everywhere on my face, on my body, and the sun, it just burns it and I get incredibly itchy. But steroids make it go like a dream, so I always have those, and I always have painkillers with me. But just in terms of for everyone, because not everyone's going to need those specific things, but just make sure you have your medications that you need, any aids that you need, anything that you need that will help you. Think in advance. Don't think of like, oh okay, today I'm alright, so I'm using this, this and this. Think of worst case scenario. Okay, so if I was having my worst day, you know, would I need this, would I need this, would I need this? Ask your doctor for it in advance. Make sure you've got it with you. And also, I got a doctor's note and took a copy of my prescription, and I kept that with all my medications in their original boxes in my hand luggage. They've never actually gone through it all, they've just kind of glanced, but you never know, and it does say that they can check it all, so just make sure you have everything the right way that you need it to be, in order to not get stopped or delay you in any way at the airport to do with medications. I think this time I'm definitely going to take a fan with me. Like I said, Florida is great in that like anywhere indoors is highly air conditioned, so you do get your like respite from the sun and the heat and you're like, oh yes. But when you are stuck in like places, I know I keep saying it, but you really do get stuck in some places in the sun, having a little battery fan or a proper fan, anything like that would be good, just to get some breeze on your skin, I think, and to cool you down. Definitely take after sun for if you do get caught in the sun and get a little bit sunburned, or even if you don't, I really find it's just great to help protect your skin after a day out in the sun, even if you don't look like red and burnt. I always put it on in Florida in the evening. I just find it, yeah, just helps my skin stay more comfortable and cool. Definitely, definitely a huge one is comfy shoes. It's like the worst thing. The amount of walking you will do, or even if you are, even in the days when I was in a wheelchair, you know, you just need comfy footwear, honestly. It's so hot, so you tend to want to go for like the least amount of stuff on your feet as possible, like the little tiny strappy sandals, but wear them beforehand and wear them in so they're comfortable. I'm the worst for this. I buy stuff new for holidays and I'm like, I don't want to wear it until the holiday, and then you wear it and it like kills your feet, you're covered in blisters. Like I said, if you've got health problems or disabilities, you don't want to add anything to that. You're already dealing with that whilst you're on holiday and looking after yourself. Don't add blisters to your list. Get comfy shoes. Going back to all the pain medications and stuff, definitely talk to your doctors before you go away. Tell them where you're going, tell them for how long, tell them what it entails, get their advice for anything they can give you to make it easier and better. At the end of the day, it's still a holiday. You want to enjoy yourself, you want to be able to have the best time possible, and your doctors, if you have disabilities or illnesses, can definitely help you do that. Hopefully. You know, if you've got a good doctor. Eat regularly. This is something that's hard because, again, I think a lot of people don't want to eat in the heat. You know, when it's really hot, it just puts you off and you're like, oh, I don't want to eat. And when you're walking around loads, or even if you're not, you just don't want to really feel like sluggish in the heat. But definitely you need to fuel your body. The amount you will sweat, even if you're not moving, in that heat is insane, especially if you're from like the UK where you're not used to it. You need to be refueling yourself on a regular basis, like every few hours. Make sure you're eating, seriously, because it makes the world of difference. You'll feel your energy absolutely bomb and you won't be able to last. Disney days are long days. You really don't want to end up ruining your evening like I have so many other times on Disney trips, because I've not eaten and then I'm absolutely starving and I've got a migraine and I'm like fatigued and I've just got no energy because I haven't eaten. Fuel your body right when you're in a Disney trip. Make sure you have travel insurance and make sure you're honest. It was hard for me when we went in 2016 because I'd been told I had lupus but hadn't been told anything other than that. I'd just been left like to fend for myself. So when I got travel insurance, I was really frightened about like, oh, do I tell them, how much is it gonna cost? But ultimately, imagine if something goes wrong when you're out there, how much more it'll cost you if you don't have travel insurance. Like, just please make sure you sort that out far, far in advance and be honest about any and all conditions that you have. And I guess my main tip to finish this off is just to know yourself. Be kind to yourself whilst you're there, but just know yourself. Think about like a combination of your worst days and your best days, and think about what you need in order to be able to relax, in order to enjoy yourself, in order to manage your pain or your condition or your illness or your disability in the best way you can, in order to be able to relax and enjoy yourself and have an actual holiday. You know, you're there because you're on holiday. You've spent a lot of money and a lot of time planning these things, often with Disney trips. So please just be honest about yourself to yourself. Say, okay, I really, really love the idea, this is for me anyway, of like being able to run around and do everything I want, but realistically I can't, and that's okay. But in order for me to have the best time still, even though I can't do those things, I need to have A, B and C in place beforehand. That's all I mean, just be prepared, know yourself, and you'll have the best time ever. It is absolutely possible to have the best holiday ever at any Disney park with a disability or a chronic illness like I do. I can't speak for anything other than Disneyland Paris or Disney World, so maybe I shouldn't have said all Disney parks, but for those, you definitely can. You plan, be prepared, and just have the most amazing, magical time. Disney World particularly, the staff are absolutely incredible. They will definitely look after you. So just relax, have fun. So yeah, those are my little tips for planning a Disney holiday with a disability or chronic illness. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have, please give it a thumbs up. If you did find it helpful, I hope you did. I hope it helps someone. I know, like again, I said, this isn't gonna work for every disability or illness or every person, but even if it helps one person, that's all I want to accomplish. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. I upload 3 new videos on Tuesdays, Fridays, and Sundays every single week, and I would love to have you. And yeah, it's going to be lots of Disney content because I'm going back to Disney World in 2019. Ah! So I need to start getting all of these and following my own tips. I hope you're having a beautiful day, and I will see you again soon. Bye!